Hello friends, namaskar and welcome. So in this session we are going to discuss non-performing asset. Friends, this term is very very important because this term is in news for over last 5 years. We are facing a huge NPA crisis for over 5 years now. So in this session I will be covering the NPA from the prelims point of view. For the mains I will be covering that topic in a separate session, right? So to start with, let us see the term non-performing asset or NPA, right? So this term has three words: non-performing and asset. First, let us understand what is the meaning of the word asset. So asset means any property which generates the income for the holder of the property. So for example, I am having an extra house and I can generate the rental income from that house. So that house becomes my property, that house becomes my asset, right? Now, in case of bank, just think, what is the asset? So, in case of bank, the asset can be in two forms. First, it can be in the form of loans and advances. And second, it can be in terms of the investment made by the bank in the government security or maybe somewhere else. Right? For the purpose of NPA, we are supposed to discuss these loans and advances. So loans and advances means the amount of money which the bank has given to the customer as the loan. So this represents the amount of loan, right? So this is the asset. Now, what is the meaning of non-performing asset? So non-performing asset means the non-performing loans and advances. So what is the meaning of non-performing loans and advances? So loans and advances we have given to the customer, the borrower. We have given them the loan, which is called as the principal amount. So the loan which we have given to a person, suppose Mr. A, the amount of loan, for example, this is 1 lakh rupees, this is called the principal. Another aspect of the loans and advances is the interest. So this principal has been given with a condition that Mr. A will be giving some amount of interest to the bank. Right? So this loans and advance is called a non-performing when Mr. A is not able to repay this principal and interest. Right? So this principal and interest is supposed to be paid to the bank as per a predefined schedule. When the customer, Mr. A, is not repaying the amount and the amount remains overdue for over 90 days, then this account is called non-performing asset, right? So non-performing means the principal is unpaid and or. So either both of them or one of them, interest is unpaid by the borrower. So in this case, this is called non-performing asset, or we also call it the bad loan. Right? Now, how do we decide that when does a loan become the NPA? Right? So for that, let us see how does the RBI classify the loan. So classification of loans
as per the RBI guidelines. So how does the RBI guideline define the classification of loans? Right. So let us suppose this loan which was given to Mr. A, this loan was given on 1st of January 2019. Now, the repayment date of this loan starts within 1 year. So within 1 year, that is on 1st of January 2020, it becomes due, right? So on 1st of January 2020, it becomes due. But at this point, it does not become overdue. So there is a difference. This is the due date. This is the due date. After this date, this amount will become overdue, right? So on 1st of January, this becomes due. And once it becomes due, after this date, if we add another 90 days, that is on 31st of March 2020, it becomes overdue. It becomes overdue, right? On 31st of March 2020, that is on the addition of 90 days from the due date, this account is classified into non-performing asset. So on this date, this account can be classified into non-performing asset, NPA. Now, the question arises, what is the condition of this amount between 1st of January and 31st of March? During this time, is there any classification of this loan or directly this becomes NPA? So before 2014, there was no focus upon this period. But in 2014, when government realized that the proportion of NPA is becoming very, very big, the RBI came up with the new term called Special Mention Account, SMA, right? So the term SMA was introduced in 2014. Now, this loan which becomes due on 1st of January, this we can classify into three different categories: 30 days from 1st of January, 60 days from 1st of January, and 90 days from 1st of January, right? So in the initial 30 days, this is called SMA0. For next 30 days, this is called SMA1. And after that, this is called SMA2. SMA means special mention account. So by classifying this account as SMA 0, 1 or 2, the bank achieves the purpose of having the good and intensive monitoring of such suspicious account. So once the amount becomes overdue, the bank starts monitoring this account as a special case, and bank starts looking into whether this account is going to be NPA in the near future. And if yes, then bank will take the suitable step. It will talk to the borrower and will ask that what is the problem? Are you facing the genuine problem? Or it will look into whether the borrower is the willful defaulter, right? So this period of 90 days is not the silent time. In this time, the bank is active and looking for that what is the future of the loan, right? During this 90 days, this loan is also called as the standard asset, right? So there is a term called standard asset. So during this 90 days, this account is also called as the standard asset. Now, coming to the 31st of March 2020, on this date, this loan became the NPA, non-performing asset. Now, what happens after this? So once this becomes NPA, after that, we further classify into different categories. So NPA is also classified into different categories. Now, what are those categories? So for the next 1 year, that is till 31st of March 2021, for the 31st March 2021, this is classified as substandard asset. Again, for the next 24 month, that is till 31st of March 2023, 31st of March 2023, this is classified as doubtful asset. Doubtful asset. And after this, this is classified as loss asset. Right? So, between 90 days and next 1 year, this is classified as substandard. Between 90 days and next 36 month, this is classified as doubtful asset. And between 90 days and more than 36 month, this is classified as the loss asset. Right? Now you can ask, sir, what is the purpose of classifying into standard asset, substandard asset, doubtful asset, loss asset? What is the purpose? So the purpose of this kind of classification, is that the bank can provide for the losses in its profit and loss. What does that mean? That means the bank can set aside a certain percentage of profit as a reserve. So it can provide for the provision or reserve. So this is called provisioning, right? So by classifying into standard, substandard, doubtful and loss asset, the bank actually takes care of the provisioning requirement. Bank will set aside a certain percentage of its profit as the provision or as the reserve, so that in the future, if this amount is uncollectible, it does not become a shock to the bank. So what are the implications of it? If a loan turning into NPA, the first implication is that this provision has to be made. So this provision is equal to how much? So this provision, in case of substandard asset, this is between 10% to 15% of the value of loan. In case of doubtful asset, this is 40% of the amount of loan. And in case of loss asset, this is 100% of the amount of loan. So if the amount of loan is 1 lakh rupees, in this time, between rupees 10,000 to 15,000, the profit amount of the bank will be reduced. In case of doubtful asset, 40,000, and in this case, entire 1 lakh rupees. There is one more thing. This loss asset is called after the expiry of 36 months or even before 36 months, when security value becomes nil. Right? So even before the 36 month, in any of these time after the 90 days, if the value of the security which has been kept by the borrower with the bank, for example, the borrower has kept some stock of goods, some stock of business goods with the bank. So, and that stock of business goods is lost in the fire. So there is a fire in the business house and the stock is lost. So in this case, the value of the security becomes zero. So in this case, even before the expiry of 36 months, this NPA will be classified as the loss asset and the 100% provisioning will be done. 100% provisioning will be done, right? So I hope the concept of SMA, NPA, standard asset, substandard asset, doubtful asset and loss asset is clear, and also the concept of provisioning requirement. So now coming back to the impact of NPA. So I said the first impact is the creation of provisioning requirement. The second impact is that the bank stops recognizing the interest amount as the income, right? So in the normal case, when the account is not NPA, in that case, the bank assumes that whatever interest is due over the customer, that interest will be realized after some time. So it is my profit. So it mentions this amount as its profit. But once the account is classified as NPA,
this interest amount which is due is not recognized as the income. Only and only if the customer deposits the interest in the form of cash. Only and only if the customer deposits the interest in the form of cash, then only we classify this amount as the interest income. Otherwise, the interest income is not recognized. Interest income is completely ignored. Right? So this is how the account is classified. Let us see a small comparison between NPA and SMA, special mention account. So NPA or non-performing asset, it has been accepted as a norm, or it is a term which has been there for a long period of time. And the origin of the SMA, it is from the 2014 onwards only, right? So origin of the term NPA is for a long time, and origin of SMA is 2014 onwards. NPA, in case of NPA, the identification of NPA, is done either by the bank, or in some cases even the auditor. If the auditor finds that the value of security is nil and the amount is overdue, in that case even the auditor can identify the amount as the NPA. So it is not only the bank, but even the auditor can classify one account as the NPA. In case of SMA, the identification is done by the bank itself. So bank has no hesitation in the classification of account as the SMA, because there is no impact on the profitability. But in case of NPA, the bank is really hesitant to classify the amount as the NPA, because it will adversely impact the profit of the bank. So bank always avoids the classification of the account into the NPA, right? Another impact is that in case of NPA, there is provisioning requirement, right? But in this case, there is no provisioning required. Now, what is the impact of provisioning? The impact is that it adversely impacts profit and loss. That means it reduces the amount of profit. And why does it happen? It reduces the amount of profit because a certain amount out of profits is kept aside, for future purposes, right? As provision. So the amount which is set aside, which starts from 10% and goes up till 100%, this amount is kept aside from the profit, and this is called as the provision. In case of NPA, there is no such requirement, right? So again, coming back, NPA has been there for a long period of time. SMA, it started after 2014 only. NPA, the identification of NPA is done by the bank and the auditor. SMA is identified by the bank itself. Provisioning requirement, there is a provisioning requirement. In case of SMA, there is no provisioning requirement. Now we will see some associated terms. So what are the terms associated with the NPA? The first term is restructured loans, right? restructured loans. So when any account turns into NPA, in that case bank always sits with the borrower and really looks into whether the default is because of genuine reasons, like economy is not doing well, exports are slowing down because of protectionism, there is high, you know, rise in the prices of raw material, there is a staff and labor problem. So what is the actual reason? If the genuine reason is there, in that case bank always tries to give some support to the borrower, right? So in this case, this restructuring is possible. In this case, this restructuring is possible, and this restructuring can involve first extension of repayment period. That means, for example, the amount is supposed to be repaid in 5 years. Now bank says that because you are not able to do that because of the genuine reasons, so you can repay in 15 years. So this relaxation is provided so that in the meanwhile, the bank, the businessman can recover from the losses. Second form of restructuring can be reduction in the interest rates. For example, the interest rate is 15%. Now the bank says because you are really, you know, bearing the losses because of genuine reasons, you can pay the rate of interest only 10%. So this reduction in the interest rate is also part of the restructuring only. Another restructuring can be in the form of infusion of additional funding. So even if the account is NPA, still the bank, if the bank thinks that just by giving a small amount of money for running the business can come back into the track. So in that case, the bank will give the loan as the additional funding. Another form can be the conversion of loan into equity. So in this case, what happens that bank converts itself from the provider of the loan to the owner. So it buys the equity to the extent of the loan it has given to the company, right? So this is also possible that bank can become the owner of the company in the extreme cases. So these are the different forms of restructured loans. Now, this is one term. Another term is stressed assets. What is the meaning of stressed assets? So stressed assets includes three different components. One is all the accounts which are NPA. So entire amount which is the NPA is one thing. Another is all the restructured account. And third is all the loans which are written off. Right? So these three combinedly, they are called stressed assets. The next term is evergreening of loans. So what is the meaning of evergreening of loans? Evergreening means increasing the period of loan by the customer itself. So how does that happen? For example, Mr. A has taken the loan from SBI, and this loan is due, the repayment is due on 1st of January 2020, and SBI is not ready to restructure the loan. Mr. A will go to Punjab National Bank and will take the loan from the PNB and repay this loan, right? So this kind of repayment which is done by Mr. A, this is called evergreening of loan, right? So evergreening of loan means taking new loan to repay old loan. taking new loan so that the old loan can be repaid. This is called evergreening of loans. Now, next term and the last term, this is regarding the NPA in case of the farm sector. So in case of the farm sector or agriculture sector, there is a little variation. How do we classify the NPA? So in case of NPA, it is in case of farm sector, it is not the 90 days which is the criteria. Rather, it depends upon the crops. So if there is a short duration crops, then the amount overdue for two crop seasons, that is called NPA. And in case of long duration crops, the amount overdue for one crop season is called NPA. So in case of farm loans, when the crop is short duration, then amount overdue for the two crop season or more, that is NPA. In case of long duration crop, the amount overdue for one crop season or more, that is NPA. Right? So there is no condition of 90 days in case of farm sector. Rather, it depends upon the duration of the crop. I hope the concepts are clear to you, and I would recommend that you fast forward this lecture and revise this lecture quickly. Right? In fact, I will do that for you right now, so that you can get this lecture on your tips. So starting from non-performing asset, the term asset here means either loans and advances or investment by the bank. We will discuss the loans and advances in this context. So when the loans and advances in the form of principal or interest, they are not paid, then it is called non-performing asset. How do we classify the loan? So when the loan is due, so in this case, if the duration of the loan is 1 year, on 1st of January 2020, it becomes due. On the due date, it is not NPA, right? From the due date for the next 90 days, this is classified into standard asset. And this standard asset is further classified into three categories: SMA 0 for the starting 30 days, SMA 1 for the next 30 days, and SMA 2 for the next 30 days. On expiry of 90 days, this becomes NPA, non-performing asset. From this date, this is classified as substandard asset for the next 1 year. From the next 1 year till the next 2 years, this is classified as the doubtful asset. And after that, this is classified as the loss asset. Loss asset can become even before the 36 month, even before this 3 years period of the NPA, when there is a security loss, right? What is the impact of classification of loan into substandard, doubtful and asset? The impact is the provisioning amount. The provisioning amount is differentiates. So in case of substandard asset, this is 10% to 15%. In case of doubtful asset, this is 40%. And in case of loss asset, this is 100%. Next, NPA versus SMA. NPA origin is for a long period of time. SMA started in 2014 only. NPA identification can be done by bank and auditor both. SMA, it is done by the bank itself. NPA provisioning requirement is there. In SMA, there is no provisioning requirement. Now, some associated terms. Restructured loans. Restructured loans, it can be in four different forms: extension of repayment period, reduction in the interest rate, additional funding, conversion of loan into the equity. Second term is stressed asset. Stressed asset can be in the form of NPA, restructured account, or loan written off. Evergreening of loan means when the new loan is taken to repay the old loan. In case of farm sector, in case of short duration crops, the amount overdue for two crop season, this is NPA. In case of long duration crop, the amount overdue for one season is the NPA. With this, I complete this session. And let me tell you, I will come up with another session where I will discuss what are the steps taken by the RBI for overcoming the problem of the NPA. With this, I complete this session. Thank you very much. God bless you.